In this video, I'm going to be walking you through three cases on how to run the bowel. And this was something that I always found to be quite difficult when I was first starting off. But over time, it gets much simpler, and I'm going to give you some tips on how to exactly do that.
For more educational resources, like our medical ID cards, check out medicalbasics.com.
And before we get started, these cases were all from casestacks.com, good resources to go through just practice cases for x-ray, CT, or MR. But the first thing that we're going to look at is just how the bowel looks like on a coronal view. I think that clinicians find it much easier to look at this because this is how you're used to seeing either KUBs or chest x-rays, so it's just a more familiar way of looking at things. So first thing, what I like to do, just kind of overview. A small bowel, just in general, is going to be in the center. Colon, aka large bowel, is going to be on the periphery. So our colon, if we're starting off with that, this is going to be our cecum and our ascending colon. It's going to be on the right side of the abdomen. We're going to come across, and this that I'm following across is going to be our transverse colon. And then coming down here is going to be our descending colon into our sigmoid colon, and then down into our rectum. Okay, and then going from the top, our stomach is going to look like this. Our stomach is going to be fairly horizontal, but kind of dipping down vertically. It's going to go into our first portion of the duodenum. Our second is going to be vertical, and we'll see why that's important in a little bit. Then our third portion is going to be this guy right here, and our fourth portion is going to be right here. Okay, so this is going to be our fourth portion of duodenum. This is all going to be jejunum. So jejunum likes to hang out in our left lower quadrant. Our ileum likes to hang out in our right lower quadrant. So we'll look at that same case in the axial plane, which is how we typically look at these. And it's kind of difficult because, at least for clinicians to visualize, is because it's cutting it in a plane that you're not used to. It's essentially cutting the abdomen like as if you're going to like guillotine someone. So cut it down straight in half, if you will, just a slice of it. So we'll start down in from the rectum. We're going to go and start into the rectum. Essentially what I'm doing right now, I'll walk you through it. I'm scrolling up. And then as soon as I don't see bowel anymore, we lose it, I'll scroll back down, right? So then I see it connects back here. So then I'll continue to scroll back up. Because remember, where the rectum is down low, and then we're trying to go up to the top where our transverse colon will be. So that's why I'm trying to go in the upward direction. But you won't just have a clear shot going all the way forward. That's why you have to go back down and then back up, down and back up. But in a general sense, you're going to always want to be going up. So now we have our sigmoid colon right here. I'm continuing to go up, up, up. And eventually I'll hit a point where I'll get to my splenic flexure, where you see your spleen. Then you're going to come across, and I'm coming down now a little bit, and you'll follow your transverse colon. That was your transverse colon down to your hepatic flexure here, down to your ascending colon. And now remember, because the ascending colon is going up, and now I'm here at the liver, I'm going to go all the way down, right? Our appendix is down in our right lower quadrant. So I'm going to continue to scroll down, all the way down. And this one, so our ascending colon kind of makes this turn here and continues to go down, and then we lose it. And right here, we'll see that this is where the ileum connects into our ileocecal valve. So this guy right here is probably our cecum, okay? So that's in general how you're looking at the colon. What we do next is we go to the top and we go to our stomach. So, you know, this is our stomach. This is going to be our fundus. It's going to be the top, our body. And then when I'm scrolling down, it's going to go to the antrum, right? So here we have our first portion of the duodenum. And then now we actually pretty quickly go into our second portion. So this is going to be our second portion all the way down here. It's more vertical. In the sense, I'll show you in another example where it's really on fa, so all you're seeing is like a donut. And then this is going to be our third portion of the duodenum. We'll continue to follow as best as we can into our fourth portion. And we can kind of continue to follow into some parts of the jejunum. As you can do as best as you can. Really, I kind of go as far as that. And then what I do for the rest of the bowel is you just kind of look at it in a global sense. So you look at it in quadrants. So four quadrant, 1, 2, 3, 4, you kind of just go up and down. Look at the bowel. Is there any focal areas that are dilated? In general, is it dilated? When you have an SBO, it's going to be very obvious. So seeing an SBO is going to be quite obvious. What's not going to be obvious is where the actual transition point comes into play, and that's where running the bowel is so important. Typically, just in terms of size criteria, all I'm doing right now is I'm just scrolling up and down to go all the different quadrants, make sure I see all the bowel. Size criteria is going to be 3, 6, and 9. Small bowel is going to be 3 centimeters in diameter as the upper limits. Colon is going to be 6. Cecum is going to be 9. And sometimes people use 12 for the stomach. So those are just general numbers for you to look at. So we're going to do something very similar with this next case. Don't mind all the fluid, the high-density fluid. This is a trauma case, so that's obviously abnormal. But essentially what you're going to look at is, if we're just looking at the bowel itself, really what you're looking for is, this is all the small bowel. You see the jejunum actually quite nicely, and as well as loops of bowel in the ileum. And then if we were to follow our stomach, this is our stomach right here. We have that coming across. It's a pretty long stomach, in the sense of horizontally. This is going to be our second portion of the duodenum. So it's going to come down very nicely, actually pretty long, before it scrolls back up into our third portion and then into our fourth portion of the duodenum. And you'll see it go back and forth, kind of like how you see in anatomy textbooks in terms of the jejunum. We're going to have our ascending colon going up like this. It's going to come across into our transverse and then going across into our splenic flexure, and then coming down into our descending colon. Eventually, it's going to come down into our sigmoid colon and then into our rectum. So same situation, we're going to start from the bottom and go up on our axial image. We'll see that we have our rectum here. It'll be coming up like that. And this is going to be our sigmoid colon. It's going to go into our ascending colon right here. And we're going to continue to follow it up. You'll notice that there's a lot more intraperitoneal fat, so we can see bowel much, much easier. So this is a good example of a situation where bowel is quite easy to follow. And then eventually it'll go into our transverse colon, into our hepatic flexure, and then going down into our ascending colon, which is this guy right here. And then right here is where our ileum comes in. So if I were to follow this loop back, you'll notice that it goes into all these different small bowel loops. So that will come in, and then it will eventually connect into our ileocecal valve. And right here, you'll see this little projection coming across here, and that's our appendix. And this looks more or less normal of an appendix, minus all the fluid around, but the fluid is from another source. I just mean more so the size of the appendix. When we come from the top, we'll see the stomach. We'll come down, and we'll see this is the second portion of the duodenum. It's like as if you cut a sausage just down the middle. That's all you're seeing because it's vertical, right? So we're just cutting it in half. And then eventually the third portion, fourth portion of the duodenum. And now we're already into the jejunum. And if you wanted, you can go back and forth and follow all these different loops of small bowel. But again, all I generally do is I just look at it in a gross setting to make sure there's no major abnormality in the small bowel. But in this situation, you probably could follow quite far in terms of the small bowel. So on this third and final case, what I'm going to show you, just going to show you the axial. This is another trauma case. So there's going to be a lot of other abnormalities. But essentially, we're going to follow from the rectum. We're going to follow, and it kind of loops back around. I'm scrolling down, and I'm scrolling back up into the sigmoid colon. It's going to come across into our descending colon. When I continue to go up, 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 it's going to go to our splenic flexure, and it's going to kind of go into this bubble here. When I continue to go up, I don't see it anymore. So I'm going to come back down, and it almost looks like it's coming down the same loop. So we'll go back and start over, and this is oftentimes what you'll have to do. You'll go up, 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 and it kind of goes into that bubble, and then when I come down, you actually see that this, if we follow it, it actually goes into this loop right here. So that's just kind of a very common problem that you'll come across in terms of following bowel. I'm continuing to come down through the transverse colon, and then we'll see it go horizontal like so. I'm scrolling back up, and then it's continuing here. This is going to be our hepatic flexure. I'll scroll back down to go down to our ascending colon, and then eventually this goes into our cecum, and then it kind of goes into this big, large portion of bowel, which is going to be our cecum. If we follow this loop here, which is our ileum, it'll eventually connect in right there. So that's going to be our ileocecal valve, and that all looks fine. Grossly, when you look at the small bowel, it looks fairly normal and it's not significantly dilated. When I start from the top and I go into the stomach, there's obviously a lot of debris in there, like they just ate right before their trauma. And then when I follow and I go down to the duodenum, I'm going to see that I see it here. This is probably the second portion of the duodenum. And then you kind of lose it. You lose it and you don't really see it here. You know, you may be able to say, oh, maybe that's part of the third portion of the duodenum, but you don't know for sure. And this is actually a much more typical case where you'll be able to follow bowel, especially the small bowel, up to a certain point, then you don't see it anymore. In this situation, I'm not particularly worried because, you know, the stomach is not very distended. The duodenum that we do see is not significantly distended. And also, even though we can't follow into the jejunum and the ileum and whatnot, it doesn't look abnormally dilated. So we're not really worried about some type of obstructive process going on right here. So I would say this is going to be a much more typical situation where, you know, like in the last situation, you had so much intraperitoneal fat, you could clearly see where all the bowel was delineated. That situation is probably going to be the more abnormal situation. I just wanted to show that to you in terms of being able to easily follow bowel. This is probably going to be a more typical situation. It's not terribly difficult. There's much more difficult ones. But just so you know, this is kind of how you would approach bowel that you can't necessarily follow. You just kind of look at it, like I was saying before, in these quadrants. So hopefully this video helped you to kind of walk you through how to follow bowel. It's less important when the bowel is normal, but once you start seeing small bowel obstructions and you want to try to follow the bowel, that's when things become much more important to know how does the bowel normally follow, how does it normally course, and being able to follow it like that. But really, the main tips for this is just practicing and seeing more cases. Anytime you scroll up or scroll down and you can't find bowel anymore, then you just go backwards and try to retrace your steps. So it's kind of a tedious process, but eventually you should be able to find all the bowel. For sure, the colon you should be able to find. The small bowel is oftentimes much more difficult.
Be sure to check out our website, medicalbasics.com, for more educational resources like our progress notebook. And don't forget to subscribe to our channel for more tips and lessons.